Congratulations, gentlemen. Thank you, Pat. Our next presenter is Mr. Joseph Marquardt, from the class of 1965. Currently a member of our English department and a former Excalibur winner.
Good evening, everyone. I've been gifted, I've been blessed. I've been blessed a few times to make presentations, both for the Excalibur Award and even once for the Hall of Fame. And it really is a wonderful privilege. I have to say this, though, that when you are inducted into the Hall of Fame, we look back and we look at 4 years and see exactly what you've done. And there were a lot of press clippings and people were there in the stands or on the field watching you. And it's rather confined, it's rather limited. When it comes to the Excalibur Award, though, there's much more. It's not just what you did here at Bishop Eustace, it's what you took from Bishop Eustace and how you developed yourself, however you developed the grace within you, and you applied that to the world, and you brought something wonderful to it. And there aren't many people. I think we only have two people. Not sure, Father Monsignor McGrath is here, and Adrian Walls, I believe, are the only two who've been recipients of both awards. It really is a remarkable thing. When I look at the five people who are being recognized tonight, Bill, as he mentioned, Bill and I were classmates. John, I'm sorry. I taught John French. And then I taught Paul and Mark and TJ. I remember when Estelle and Tommy brought you here when you were born. So, you know, that's how old I am or how young you are. Okay, Mark Morgan. One of the wonderful things about this is you have a student class and freshman year, sophomore year, whatever, and you make it a fix on the personality, you make it a fix on their character, but you never know what is going to happen over time. With Mark Morgan, if you saw him in class, attentive, had to know exactly what you were talking about, took down his notes, did very well. Simon's always done, very attentive, solid student. On the wrestling mat, laser-like focus, and that was, I think, the one of the main causes for his great success, beyond his obvious talent. But then we have to look at what happened to Mark after he left Bishop Eustace. I took his wonderfully detailed CV that I got from Rich Banner and tried to reduce it just to give you a flavor of what Mark has done since he left Eustace. Okay. He went to Rutgers and he studied microbiology and graduated with his degree in 77. He graduated cum laude from the State University of New York in 1982 at something called the Downtown Medical Center. This really sounds like hipsters would be there. University of Pennsylvania next. He was an intern, served his residency and his postdoctoral. He was a postdoctoral fellow at the University of Pennsylvania. He seemed to have found a home. He seemed to, except for those couple of years up in New York, he seemed to have found a home, not just in the Delaware Valley, but especially at the University of Pennsylvania. There at the University of Pennsylvania, on the faculty, first as an assistant instructor, then assistant professor, obstetrics and gynecology. associate professor, then full professor, and then finally in 2006, adjunct professor, only because he was moving on to greater challenges. He was a professor of surgical oncology at the Fox Chase Cancer Center in Philadelphia. And then he became chief of gynecologic oncology at the same time that he was still maintaining his ties and pay, and he was working full-time, as it were, at Fox Chase. He also found time to be an adjunct professor at the Temple University School of Medicine, home to Penn. In 2013, as professor of gynecologic oncology. I've never said the word gynecologic or gynecology so much in my life. I could give you the entomology. I could give you the etymology of the word, but I never thought I'd be saying it this often. Now at Penn, Mark is he's the chief of the Division of Gynecologic Oncology for the entire University of Pennsylvania Healthcare System. Honors. I just tried to whittle down to give you a few samples. 1981, the Alpha Omega Alpha Medical Honor Society. 1986-87, Clinical Fellowship Award from the American Cancer Society. 1994, Award for Excellence in Teaching from the Association of Professors of Gynecology and Obstetrics. From the Consumer Research Council of America's, here's the title, Guide to America's Top Oncologists. He was named one of the best in the country. In 2014, he was named to the Academy of Master Clinicians by the University of Pennsylvania. All right. He stayed local. Let's move out beyond the Delaware Valley. In 2000, he was appointed a traveling fellowship in gynecologic endoscopy, a new word, in Lyon, France. Since 2010, he's found time to work for, God knows the boy has energy. Since 2010, he's worked for the World Health Organization as team leader in, another new word, Genitourinary Reproductive Medicine Technical Advisory Group. He's the team leader of whatever that means. In Geneva, Switzerland. Also for the World Health Organization in 2012. He is a technical consultant. Mark, you're going to have to explain this to me. Maternal Morbidity Working Group. Whatever that is, but it does sound interesting. I'm sure it's important for the World Health Organization. Lectures. There are about 3 pages of lectures and publications, but just to give you a sample of lectures. First of all, of course we have a lot here in Metropolitan Philadelphia, even one that was given in Vineland. Go west to Denver and go south to Orlando. But, you know, stretching his wings, you know, that World Health Organization in Geneva, I think, gave him a taste of travel. In 2008, he lectured in Graz, Austria. 2011, Dusseldorf, Germany. 2014, Tochigi, Japan, and Lilongwe, Malawi. I hope that's correct. Publications, I can't pronounce half the words, so I won't even, but they're around like 3 pages, so trust me. But there's one publication that I think really says much about the growth of this young man from the classroom and the wrestling match, you know, and then spreading his wings. There's an article I have upstairs that could show you if you want to look at it. There's an article with photos from the Fox Chase Cancer Center in 2007. Mark worked for an outreach program that was started at Stanford University, not a bad academic institution, where it shows a picture of Mark with his colleagues. And then there's a picture of Mark standing on a hillside overlooking a village where he worked twice a year in Dekin Hara, Eritrea, in the Horn of Africa. So, you know, you do, you find, you succeed, and then has often been said tonight, and then you reach, and you see what more you can do, and you see what you can do for others. And that seems to be what this young man has done. Okay? Mark?
Thank you very much, Joe, and thank Bishop Eustace for this award. Mr. Mark Hart was certainly a loved and respected teacher when I was at Bishop Eustace, and I'm surprised that he's still here because he must have influenced a lot of people through the years, a lot of young men and women. I'm honored to have this award and to join the distinguished graduates that have had it before, especially my classmates, Dan Waters, Gene Gaddy, and Ed Spytel. Two of those right now are in Panama celebrating their 60th birthday, so they couldn't be here, but they're having a little vacation. When I graduated from Bishop Eustace in 1973, I really never imagined that I would get such an honor. 1973 was an interesting time. As you probably know, the Vietnam War was winding down at that time. The civil rights movement was in full swing. There were riots in the streets and on the campuses around the country. And our country at that time's future was really uncertain. If you go across the world, there was a famine in Ethiopia. And a raging civil war that would eventually gain independence for the Ethiopian state of Eritrea, a tiny country on the Horn of Africa, which little did I know would somehow really play a part in my life in the future. But there were many positives around that time. The music was pretty good. But I was listening to the 70 channel on the way here, and Disco Inferno was playing, and I thought, well, maybe it wasn't that good. There was this new thing called an electronic calculator, where you know you could do your math on a, instead of using a slide rule, you calculators were just coming out. And when I went away to college, that was the first Texas Instrument calculators. My brother, who was a Bishop Eustace graduate, would one day be a vice president of Texas Instruments. Man had landed on the moon 6 times by that time, and the genetic code was starting to be broken. Notably, a viral gene that caused cancer in chickens was found to have a similar sequence in the DNA of humans. That was the first recognized oncogene, or a gene that causes cancer. As co-editor of the 1973 yearbook with Rick Novak, who I think is in the Athletic Hall of Fame here now, we picked 2 quotes to highlight the introduction of the yearbook and to represent our class. First quote was, "We lived with hearts that ran and hands that dream and clocks that have no hour hands." And the other one was, "Man lives among others and perhaps 4 others." Over 40 years since I've graduated, I can't help but think that those 2 quotes really guided my future. I've been fortunate enough to see the first African-American president with the dream that health care should be available to all Americans. I was fortunate to use some of the first personal computers to do medical research. When I finished my medical training, I did radical surgery through large incisions. Patients were in the hospital for weeks after that kind of surgery. Now I frequently do surgery through tiny little incisions with 3D imagery and robotic assistance. The human genome has been decoded, and researchers in my laboratories at the University of Pennsylvania are using that information to target the genetic defects that cause cancer. These defects are different for different cancers, and they're also different among individuals with the same cancer. We're also reteaching the immune system to recognize cancers as a foreign invader. If any of you have been to the Pennsylvania Hospital over in Philadelphia in the historic area, that's the oldest hospital in the country. There's a plaque when you go into the old building that quotes the Gospel of Matthew. And the quote is one of my favorites. "Inasmuch as ye have done it unto one of the least of these, my brethren, you have done it to me." I've had the honor to travel to Eritrea, a country that was fighting civil war back in 1973, to treat what many people would call some of the least of these, my brethren. These are poor women in a poor country with something called obstetric fistula, which are childbirth injuries, once common in America and in the developed world, that no longer exist here, that leaves women incontinent and outcast from society. Over 10 years, we have built a sustainable program to care for these women and fix these injuries. I've had a wonderful life, and my adventure really started with my early morning bus rides from Woodbury to Pennsauken. I grew up in West Africa, took the bus from Woodbury. In those days, there were no school busing, so we had to take the public transportation. We took the bus into Camden, and then from Camden, we took the Red Arrow bus to Bishop Eustace. My parents insisted that I make this trip every day. My father was a career chief in the Navy, and so I was a Navy brat and traveled around the country when I was younger. My mother was a diploma nurse and inspired me to go into medicine, but they insisted that I be the first Morgan to graduate from college, which I was. I also I want to thank the love of my life, my wife Beverly, who is here, and she supported and guided me through all those post Bishop Eustace years. I know it's hard being a wife of a military person. It's also hard being wife of a doctor. She's given me four special children who I am just so proud of, and one of them's here, Christopher, who is a graduate of the University of Pennsylvania and works as an anesthetist at Fox Chase Cancer Center now. I had the honor of having him do some of my cases when I was at Fox Chase. Finally, I want to thank those who chose me for this honor and the institution that is Bishop Eustace and all that it does for everyone. I hope future graduates also can live with hearts that run, hands that dream, and clocks that have no hour hands, and that they not only live among others, but for others, just like the class of 1973. Thank you.